Robert, if I may, I mean, are you seriously suggesting that a firm which is acting for the seller of a house should also be able to instruct, as part of its in-house service, the surveyor to produce the survey, which in turn is going to be relied upon by the purchaser, in a situation which is notoriously difficult and likely to lead to all sorts of disputes between the parties about the details of it, if there's dry rot that's not identified or there's, you know, there's issues of that sort?
I think there's provision in the bill for that kind of regulatory conflict to be worked out, and you know, I think that's part of the protections in the bill.
Take us a little further, though, as how you'd see that operating, because I think we need to see what the practicalities of that sort of situation are.
Mm-hmm. So in terms of the survey being prepared by the sellers...
Well, are you suggesting that's a likely possibility in the sort of service you would envisage being provided by this new entity?
No, not necessarily, but it does give the option of providing those services together. You know, it doesn't. The same company wouldn't necessarily be acting for buyer and seller, but the home report would be prepared by the seller's team,
by
if you wish.
The legal entity, if you like.
Yes, by the legal entity.
Providing survey services as well. I wonder if I can ask the Office of Fair Trading's view on that rather extraordinary proposition, if I may say so.
Well, I just wanted to add one consideration. We are, in fact, in the process of doing a market study of home buying and selling in the Office of Fair Trading, and obviously looking as part of that at the operation of Home Report. And one of the questions that obviously arises is who will be the surveyor involved, and there obviously are other interests. In particular, we hear of the interests of the lenders and whose surveyor they will wish to use. So there are a number of parties here who will direct which aspects or which particular service supplier will be appropriate and chosen. So it may be that it is appropriate in a particular case for the surveyor in the same firm as the lawyer concerned in the transaction to be involved, or not, but that doesn't in itself reduce the opportunities to place the survey service in the right place to achieve the independence you look for.
The thing I'm really asking is there a conflict of interest in that situation, and how is the public interest advanced by that, given the notorious potential, if you like, of conflict between the buyer and the seller, but all sorts of details relating to things on which the survey has made a report?
As I understand it, that's part of the whole purpose of the home report, is to take some of the sting out of that and to provide an objective study which will be available, as Julia said, to both sides of the transaction.
Not taken away in substantial measure, and the potential of confidence in it, if it's all, if you like, dealt with, not just, if you like, even at arm's length, but in the same entity that is actually acting for the seller. Sorry to press the point, it seems to me to be quite a fundamental one.
Well, I think it has already been referred to the control, as it were, that's built into the bill to ensure that there are the highest professional services, whether or not you have professionals from different professions working together, or if they're working individually. So we wouldn't anticipate that there'd be any reduction in the levels of professionalism, and therefore the confidence that consumers would be able to have in the services that are being made available.
Just to conclude on that one, I mean, you might as well say, might you not, that the same solicitor should act for the purchaser and the seller, do the whole thing in the house, and let's just get rid of any of the associated additional costs of having separate representation. I don't think so, right? Okay. Thank you.
Cathy Craig has got a point.
Still on that, on that point, Julia Clark said that when talking about the consumer's interest, that the market will adapt to what consumers want. Stuart Maxwell, I think, very helpfully brought in the point that, you know, we have a lot of large companies working as a almost one-stop shop in terms of house sales and purchases, and yet we still have the solicitor working in the small high street who is able to provide. So consumers have chosen what they want. I don't have any satisfactory answers to say what benefits the proposals in this bill will bring to the consumers, and probably the majority of the people that I represent the biggest number would go and see their lawyer about house transactions rather than anything else.
Well, I think that's absolutely right, and there, in my opinion, there'll always be a place for the solo high street lawyer that everybody knows and trusts and people have always gone to, and I think that will continue to be the case. But for some companies, they do want to, you know, modernise their services, if you like, streamline and perhaps cut some of the costs associated with that. And in Scotland, we could use a bit of competition, frankly, in this area to improve services and to drive down costs a little bit. And I think if we free people up to offer that, then people will take advantage of it. If it's there, you know, it's
Yes, I think that there are two aspects to this. One is that consumers haven't had the choice of making one visit to a firm which might offer them both legal and accounting services, for example, at a local level. So, and we have heard that they favour the idea of a one-stop shop. So this may still be a theoretical demand, but it's one that has been reported to us. We also make the point that it's been referred earlier to the profitability of services. If it doesn't work, firms won't stick with it. But they are saying to us that they think that there is an opportunity here that will reduce costs and will therefore make the services cheaper for consumers, and that they'd like to be able to develop that. Firms will not have to do this. If they wish to stay as individual practitioners of just one service or another, then that remains part of the market mix. But what is proposed is going to allow them to do things in new ways which may drive more imagination and better service.
You know, some people would say that it's not broken just now, so why fix it? Why say that it isn't working? And the big issue, the concern that I have, that if it doesn't work and the firms don't stick with it, as you suggest, then what happens to the small solicitors firm that was working in the high streets that I represent, who has disappeared because these bigger firms come in, took the business from them for a time, and they just don't come back. They've retired or they've gone to work for one of these big firms and maybe lost out.
Clearly, the sustainability of services is of great importance. But at the moment, we're seeing sole practitioners in high streets having a very difficult time in sustaining their services. There is every opportunity that in offering new models, they will have a greater chance of being able to sustain their services. So that's an important aspect going forward. And there are many new ways in which consumers are accessing services of all sorts, and they wish to be able to do that in wider ways. Mention was made of IT and buying online. Obviously, the whole issue of transactions taking place face-to-face is changing dramatically in all our transactions, and there is no reason that legal services will be any different. We're seeing online transactions in house buying and selling and in other ways of accessing very important and still customised service, but not necessarily doing it through an office in a high street.
Aspect of the bill, very briefly, Stuart Maxwell.
Thanks, Convener. I mean, I opened up this line of question because I was trying to get to the bottom of what practical difference the bill would make to individual consumers, and I'm still trying to get to the bottom of that question. You stated, Ms. Brand, that consumers would benefit from getting joint legal and accountancy services, was the example you gave. Who specifically are these consumers? Because I was trying to think who it would be, because I mean, I can see businesses might find that as an advantage, but the bulk of them, probably my constituents like Cathy Craigie's, are not businesses, they're individuals who go and seek legal services, and therefore they don't seek legal and accountancy services. So is it just that some businesses, small or otherwise, would benefit from this particular bringing together of legal and accountancy services, or is there some wider benefit that I just haven't envisaged?
I would like to give the impression that people will be flocking to acquire legal and accounting services on the same day and on the same issue, but many of us do find